Well, hello and welcome to Outdoor Oklahoma. I'm Todd Craighead. Managing a proper amount of pond vegetation can sometimes be challenging, but our biologists have several tools in their toolbox to address the issue, including this unique boat for physically removing unwanted excess vegetation. Is it a weed eater boat, or is it a lawnmower boat, or is it a giant water rake boat? Well, the answer is yes. It's all of the above and then some. Fisheries biologists with some of the coolest tools of the trade to keep our ponds and lakes in top condition. Just another reason to love Oklahoma and the adventures that await you.
If you hear someone squealing out here in the middle of November on a Saturday afternoon, it's probably me because I caught a fish. All of my family and my friends, they think I'm crazy. So during the pandemic, I got into kayaking shortly before the pandemic started. And then when we were all kind of isolated, kayaking was my escape, you know, to get me out of the house. And so every day almost I was on the water. I personally do not know of anyone else doing kayak jug fishing anywhere else. It was just kind of a necessity for me. I'm like, well, I don't have a boat, but I have a kayak. I'm using goldfish and minnows for bait. Today I'm doing some jug fishing. And what that is either some homemade kind of device that you've got that floats, that has all your information on it. This one is a disc jug. And what will happen is I've got two hooks on this jug. I'll put my bait on there, have it weight. I lower into the water, lower the disc, yellow side up. And I know when I've got something hooked when the jug flips. So that's what I'm gonna be doing right now. So typically for when I jug fish, I have two hooks on each jug. You can have more, but for me, two hooks is about what I can tolerate. And I typically do four jugs at a time. And I like to use minnows, large minnows and goldfish. They like the orange shiny stuff, and of course they love large minnows, so try to feed them what they want. Yeah, so I don't have any electronics, and I will watch the water and I'll watch the birds, and I will kind of locate the channel from that. So the channel typically runs like right through here, and so I just space them, give them a good space, but place them right here in the middle of the channel and just wait for the fish to come. This is always, if I'm not sure where to fish, I will run my lines this way and then this way. And whenever I get a consistent bite in an area, then I start lining them up right there. For me, this spot is the spot. So just put them all right through here to about that tip right there, anywhere in between here, and tend to do pretty good. On a really calm day, you can end up seeing the channel. The birds tend to kind of follow in that spot, anywhere you are on the lake. And growing up, my dad always taught me, you know, you want to follow the birds. Typically the birds will tell you a lot about what's going on in the water. And that I still find to be true, you know, 20 years later, 30 years later. So my dad loved to fish. This is one of, if not his most favorite pastime, catfishing, bass fishing, crappie fishing, anything on the water fishing, and he just loved it. So naturally, I was a daddy's girl tag along, and you know, I have two hands, so he's like, you're gonna learn to fish. And I remember vividly being three or four years old, standing in the driveway or in the front yard and casting, and just over and over and over again. And it was always him prepping the boat for a trip that we were gonna go out on, or maybe he was gonna go out on and I couldn't go. So that's how he got me excited anyway. And so then as I got to a little bit older and would listen better, he would take me out and we'd go fishing. And then every time he would come home and he would clean the fish. He had a process that he followed. And I would just sit on the counter and watch him clean all of this fish. And it was just natural, normal for us. And when I decided that I was gonna start keeping my fish and using it as a food source, all of those memories of watching him do it came back. It was like second nature. I remembered exactly how to do it from just watching the process repeatedly. And so for me, in many ways, catfishing, being out here on the water, is like hanging out with my dad again. There are certain conversations that we didn't get to have when I was an adult, but in many ways, going through his tackle or going through the process, it's like he's giving me advice. I know what he's saying by the stuff that's in his tackle box. All right, guys, it's been a couple hours, so we're just gonna check. Looks like we've got some activity. So we're gonna check and see if we've got anything. Oh. Oh yeah, we got something. It's already been caught too. It's about I'd say 3 to 5 pounds. Good sized fish. It's already been caught before. Yeah, it's a beautiful fish.
It's been, kind of a trip down memory lane. The more further into the fishing I go, the more memories, kind of resurface, and it just makes you feel really good. It is, it's a journey back home. Over time, it's just kind of become my peace. Spending time outdoors, whether it's fishing, kayaking, or just sitting here watching the water, brings me a lot of therapy. I know it can be a sport for some people, but for me, that activity is just getting kind of close back to my roots.
Oh yeah, we get us another fish, for sure. It's pulling. There's a little channel cat.
This is one of my passions, for sure. I thought it was a little quirky because I hadn't seen anybody else doing it. But yeah, I will be doing this as long as my body allows me for the rest of my life. And it's a great way to feed my family, have fun, get some exercise, spend time in nature. And it's something I hope that my children will pass on to their children. If I could, I'd be out here all the time, every day.
All right, guys, so we've been out here for several hours, about 5 hours or so, and we've been waiting, and within about 10 minutes, both of these flipped. We got two different species of catfish in about 10 minutes. It's worth it, even if you're just out here waiting. That's why they call it fishing.
My mom is pretty proud. I have two daughters, and they're very proud that I'm catching big fish, not just little fish. It's something that my dad and I shared. I think that it brings a lot of happiness in my for my family to see that that's still going on.
Dog barks, I start smiling.
Yeah, me too.
And the more they bark, the more I smile.
It's kind of like music to me. You know, each dog's got a personality, really. I guess it's not a personality, I guess it's a dog-anality. And they're individuals, and they act individually, but then when they kind of like a common goal, and out here it's a rabbit. And so they work together.
As a team,
after they once get on that rabbit, then they'll work together as a team, and like bird dogs honor each other, rabbit dogs honor each other. If a dog is reliable, those other dogs knows he's reliable. When he barks, if there's a rabbit there, those other dogs know that. And likewise, when a dog barks a lot and sometimes there isn't a rabbit there, those dogs will get to recognize that too. And they won't respond as quickly, but we've worked these dogs together for a few years now, and they work good together as a team. Yeah. Well, some of them have a chop mouth, which is a short, you know,
give
a short
demonstration,
bark.
Jim.
It's a chop. And some of them have a ball, which is a long drawn out, and we've got some of both of those, and then we've got a squall or two. If we ever get going here directly, well, you'll hear them all.
And some sound like a rooster crowing that doesn't really have any other comparison to it other than a rooster crowing. But each of them has their own sounds. And if one of them hits a really fresh trail and barks, the others will respond to that, knowing they work together in teamwork and they combine to make a pack. And then the whole pack will go to that trail. And if they lose it, then when the first one that hits it again, the others will rally to that dog and join together to chase the rabbit.
I think they're gonna get it going. Let's ease on down just a little bit further. I think they're gonna finally get this thing going.
When the dogs begin to scent a rabbit, some of the dogs with a really good nose can smell a rabbit that may have been there several hours before. And as that barking increases to a certain point, they will track the rabbit down to his daytime bed and move that rabbit. And that rabbit is like any person would logically do after being run out of his bed, would make a circle around, hope to outrun the dogs and come back to his bed, hope the dogs won't follow him. But it's somewhat an elliptical or circular path, most normally, that they run in. And we look for an opening somewhere between where the dog started the rabbit and where we think the rabbit will come back to his home range and wait for the rabbit to come by. Usually the rabbit's quite a few minutes ahead of the dogs and takes his time. And instead of running, you hear the dogs running, you think they're like a fire, been going to a fire in a fire truck. The dog's running fast, but the rabbit's just hop, 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 hopping along.
Tell him about he licking his
and
paw.
And every now and then, the rabbit stop, he'll take a paw, lick all the moisture off of it, like so.
They do that.
They do that. I've seen them do that. I wouldn't make it up.
I've seen enough rabbits to know that it looks like, I'm not saying it does, but it looks like they kind of enjoy it. It's hard to know what a rabbit's gonna do. Yeah, they generally do make some kind of a rough circle. These swamp rabbits, if you're running swamp rabbits, they'll run a circle up to, you know, half, three quarters of a mile.
might be, like Joe said, an elliptical kind of a circle. And a lot of times they'll go down to the end and make some small circles and then line back out and come back to you. You just have to guess. You just have to guess. If those dogs can stay on him long enough, he'll do the same thing three or four times if they can stay with him. And that's what we're looking for here. If they can stay with him, I think he'll be back here because he's been here about three times.
Here comes the rabbit. Here he comes. Here he is. I got him.
Got him, then you jumped.
I got him.
You know, I've been knowing Joe since 1988. And when I met him, he was a game warden and I wasn't. And years went by and we worked together. I was a park ranger and I helped him some and he helped me some. And we developed a good strong bond, a good strong friendship. And he's retired now, so I used to get to work with him there. I got on as a game warden. He helped me, I'll just tell you. Kind of gave me some pointers. And he's retired now and has been for the last few years. And this is where we get together and have and keep our friendship strong and visit and talk about family and good things like that. So that's what we do besides just the rabbit hunting.
I've got a young swamp rabbit out of eastern Oklahoma. He's been running through the water this morning. He's got a lot of water on him. If Jim and I had, in modern terminology, a USB cord to plug into each other, we'd exchange lots of information the time we're together. A lot of people don't know or don't have this camaraderie or have a common goal that we do things together. And maybe they do something different, I'm not sure.
That's how it all works. They're hot on the trail. Maybe he'll circle again. If he does, maybe we'll get him this time. I would like more people to rabbit hunt. At the same time, it's competition. And you know, people get into your spots you like to hunt, your favorite spots. But it's such a good, I think it's a good, clean sport. Smooth miss that first shot. We'll let the dogs find it. That way they know it's done. You don't have to kill a rabbit every time you go. You don't have to kill a rabbit every fifth time you go. You can go and enjoy the product that you've produced. You can breed your dogs, raise puppies, train them. A lot of enjoyment comes in training puppies and watching them develop and watching them learn how to operate like their mom and dad did. Good dogs, good dogs, good dogs, good girl, good girl, good girl. There's your swamp rabbit, about a 6-pounder, 5.5, 6-pound rabbit. Not too many of those left in a lot of the state of Oklahoma. There's still some down here in southeastern Oklahoma. Anyway, dogs did good. I didn't shoot as good as I should have, but anyway, we got us one. There he is, Sassy. It's just fulfilling to me to get to do that, and I think it would be for others too. I wish more people did.
You're a good girl. That's OG, isn't it? groupie. How y'all doing, huh? Oh, you finally got that old rascally rabbit right up here. No, Jim finally shot it for you. He's a good boy. Hello there. Hello there, Spot. You're a good girl. You good rabbit dog. You good rabbit dog.
And you don't always have to shoot a rabbit. We don't shoot rabbits all the time. But we did today. It's a good thing to do once in a while. We take some home and we cook them up and we eat them and we like them. But the sport of running the dogs, I think, is what convinces us that we should hit the woods with our beagles, and it gives us a motivation to get out and move around and get a little exercise and enjoy the great outdoors of Oklahoma.
Yes, and what else could you do on a day like today rather than get outside and get some exercise like a 74-year-old man that I am? What motivation would you have to get out and get exercise with rabbit hunting?
Good dog.
And the dogs like to see and smell what they've been chasing.
Good dog.
Even Sassy, maybe she'll learn her collar today. Well, I don't know. We might give her another time or two.
All right.
You ready to load him up, Jim?
All right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, load him up, Joe. Yep. On to the next one. See if we can get another started.
Laverne, what are you doing?
She's running her daddy.
All the shorebirds that spend time in Oklahoma, the killdeer is probably the most common and the most familiar. Their loud call is easily recognized, and the broken wing display that draws predators and humans from the nest is legendary. Killdeer are brown and white, kind of robin-sized birds that have fairly long legs. They have pointed wings, a longish tail, and an orange rump. The two dark bands at the neck help distinguish killdeer from other closely related plovers. These birds can be found in Oklahoma year-round. They're closely tied to the water, but can also be found in upland fields and in developed areas. They'll make use of gravel roads, flat roofs, and even ball fields and golf courses during the nesting season. Instead of building a nest with twigs or leaves, killdeer scrape dirt, grass, and rocks to form a small depression on the ground. To make up for their very open nest, the eggs and chicks are extremely well camouflaged. But if you get too close, an adult bird is likely to try and draw your attention away by making distress calls and pretending to have a broken wing. As soon as you follow the adult far enough from the nest, they'll quickly drop the ruse and fly away. If you enjoyed learning about Oklahoma's incredibly diverse fish and wildlife, I encourage you to share your own field notes. Uploading your photographs and sighting details to apps like eBird and iNaturalist is one of the best ways to get involved in conservation.
We hope today's stories remind you that Oklahoma is a perfect place to explore. So however you choose to enjoy our state's incredible natural world, remember, your adventure starts with Outdoor Oklahoma. Is that a wrap? Outdoor Oklahoma is produced by the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife Conservation and is proud to serve and be funded entirely by sportsmen and women and outdoor enthusiasts who love and appreciate all things wild in the great state of Oklahoma.